Hey folks, Dr. Chapman here. Today we're going to talk about Yosemite, the Sierra Nevada batholith, and igneous processes. The massive cliff faces, canyons, and domes of Yosemite, Kings Canyon, and Sequoia National Parks in the Sierra Nevada mountains in California are mostly made of granitic rocks. Granitic is a generic term that just means like granite. Granite is also a catch-all term for non-specialists that is applied to all sorts of igneous and metamorphic rocks. But true granite refers to a rock with a specific composition. The next time someone shows you their granite countertops in their home, there's a very high chance that those countertops are not true granite. Not to say that there's anything inherently better about true granite countertops compared to other rock types.
What did you say?
Some of the rocks in Kings Canyon, Yosemite, and Sequoia National Parks are true granite, but there are many other intrusive igneous rock types as well, like diorite, granodiorite, and tonalite, that are equally or even more abundant. You can classify intrusive igneous rocks by looking at the percentage of the minerals quartz, plagioclase feldspar, and potassium feldspar, three of the most abundant minerals in granitic rocks.
Pardon my intrusion, but
these rocks are called intrusive because they intruded into the earth as magmas and then cooled down and crystallized and hardened very slowly over thousands to millions of years. Most of the intrusive rocks in Yosemite were originally emplaced as magma 7 to 10 kilometers beneath the surface of the earth. The surrounding country rocks helped to insulate the magma and keep them from cooling down too fast. Because these magmas cooled slowly, the minerals or crystals had time to grow large enough to be seen with the naked eye. Igneous rocks with relatively large interlocking minerals are called phaneritic, and this texture is what tells us that they are intrusive rocks. Conversely, magmas extruded or erupted at the surface of the earth into air or water are quenched and cool down very rapidly. So the minerals in those rocks do not have time to grow. And a microscope is usually needed in order to see the individual minerals or crystals. This texture is called aphanitic, and it helps us recognize extrusive or volcanic rocks. There's also an intermediate form or texture of igneous rocks called porphyritic, where some crystals were able to grow and others were not. These rocks, generally formed at shallow depths in Earth's crust, partially crystallized at depth, and then were erupted before the entire rock could fully crystallize. For example, consider an aphanitic andesite and a porphyritic andesite. The white crystals in this rock are mainly plagioclase, and the black minerals are mainly amphibole. The granitic rocks in Yosemite, Kings Canyon, and Sequoia National Parks are all part of the Sierra Nevada batholith. A batholith is a huge mass of intrusive igneous rock that is itself made up of many smaller intrusive bodies, including plutons and dikes and sills. Most of the Sierra Nevada batholith formed around 100 million years ago during the Cretaceous period. The batholith represents an amalgamation of magma chambers that once fed a chain of large explosive volcanoes called a continental arc, because the volcanoes form on the edge of a continent, in this case, the North American continent. The volcanoes and volcanic rocks that were once present above the Sierra Nevada have been eroded away. If we could take a peek several kilometers into the earth beneath active volcanoes like Mount St. Helens or Mount Rainier, we would find rocks with similar compositions to those in the Sierra Nevada batholith. I mentioned earlier that the intrusive rocks in the Sierra Nevada span a range of compositions, from more mafic rocks like gabbro and diorite that have lots of magnesium and iron-bearing minerals, to more felsic rocks like granodiorite and granite that are mostly composed of feldspar and quartz. To understand why the composition of these igneous rocks varies so much, let's take a look at the Tuolumne Intrusive Suite in Yosemite National Park. The Tuolumne Intrusive Suite is a zone plutonic complex with older, more mafic phases on the margins and younger, more felsic phases in the center, which suggests that the source of the Tuolumne magma evolved over time from a more mafic composition to a more felsic composition. The three main processes that have been hypothesized to produce this range of magma compositions are magma mixing, assimilation, and fractional crystallization. Magma mixing or mingling is the easiest to understand, and intermediate compositions like granodiorite could be produced by mixing of a mafic gabbroic magma with a felsic granitic magma. Just like mixing black and white paint.
And let's put a few little happy clouds in here.
Irregular shaped enclaves of mafic rocks within larger felsic intrusion units have been associated with magma mixing. The second process, assimilation, also involves mixing, but in this case, the magma mixes in and melts part of the host rock or the country rock. A mafic gabbroic magma could melt and incorporate a sandstone country rock, and the result would be a more quartz-rich or felsic final composition. Pieces of country rock are commonly found inside igneous bodies and are evidence for assimilation. These pieces of country rock are called xenoliths. The prefix xeno comes from ancient Greek and means stranger or foreigner, so xenolith is a rock foreign to the original magma. The third process, fractional crystallization, is a little harder to understand, but it may be the most important for producing the spectrum of igneous rock compositions. As a magma body cools, mafic minerals tend to crystallize first, and these may settle to the bottom or to the sides of a magma chamber. The melt left over is now more felsic than it previously was because the early forming crystals have pulled out elements like magnesium. This process can continue through time so that when the last bit of magma crystallizes, the resulting rock coming from that melt is very felsic, like a granite. Intrusive suites like the Tuolumne suite that show a complete spectrum of rock compositions from old, early crystallizing mafic rocks to young, late crystallizing felsic rocks support the model of fractional crystallization. The average composition of the continental crust on Earth is intermediate, like an andesite or granodiorite. And many geoscientists have suggested that fractional crystallization processes in continental arcs, like the one that created the Sierra Nevada batholith, are what originally created continental crust. Once created, continental crust tends to stick around, and the oldest rocks on Earth are pieces of continental crust that are 3 to 4 billion years old. So unless you live in Hawaii or some other island in the ocean, you may have fractional crystallization to thank for the ground beneath your feet. Perhaps millions or billions of years ago, there was a place like Yosemite in the Sierra Nevada batholith where you are now.
Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.